So let me say, recapitulate the basic idea once again. For any two-dimensional motion problem, you have to first select a suitable origin and a suitable set of coordinate axes. The displacement, as we go from one position to another, the displacement vector as you go from one position to another, then remembering that what we are saying is that we are looking at the motion of a particle from two different frames of reference. The magnitude of the displacement vector is under root 2r, right? If you divide this displacement by the time taken for making this displacement, then you will get the value of the average velocity vector, right? The time taken to complete this will be 1/4 of the total time period, which you can write again in terms of omega. 2 pi by omega is the time period, so it will be how much? 1/4 of that. So how much that becomes? Pi by 2 omega. So if you divide this by this displacement vector by the time taken, you will get the value of the average velocity. And you can calculate its magnitude. Similarly, if you calculate the velocity vector at this position and then the velocity vector at this position from this general definition of the velocity vector and find the change, that will be the change in velocity. And again, if you divide it by the time taken, you will get the value of the average acceleration. So you can work out the magnitude and you can very easily see that the two are not equal to each other. So here you notice that the velocity vector at the start, where omega t is 0, will be just r omega times j. And here at this position, where omega t is pi by 2, it will be just this component, and this component will become 0, right? So here you will have the velocity vector like this. Here you have the velocity vector like this. So at this position, it has only a y component. At this position, it has only a x component, right? And you can find the change. So the magnitude of the change, because it is r omega minus r omega I at the final position and r omega j at the initial position, it will be minus r omega I minus r omega j. The magnitude will be under root 2 times r omega. And that divided by the time taken will give us the value of the average acceleration. So here the instantaneous and the average accelerations will not be the same, right? You also notice that here, if you have to find the displacement as we go from one position to another, the displacement vector as you go from one position to another, then remembering that we have the rate of change of displacement as V, or you should better put it as the instantaneous velocity as dr by dt. You can write dr as V dt. Right? And that of course means that if we were to integrate from, say, we call this as t equal to 0 to t equal to, so let us say t by 4, the position vector at this position is s1, at this position is s2, then this will be integral of v dt, and you can integrate this expression. You can integrate this expression. So if you integrate this expression, you will get, if you integrate minus sine omega t, what will you get? Cos omega t divided by omega. Cos omega t divided by omega. Right? And if you integrate this, then you will get minus sine omega t divided by omega. So you can find the change in the value of these positions at the final position and the initial position of the particle. So analyzing uniform circular motion through this will be a little difficult, because you are now having a case of variable acceleration. That is why using the conventional approach will be a little more convenient over here. You can easily verify that even if you use this approach and do your calculations, you will always get identical and exact results. But of course, you will have to be careful about the integration that you carry out. Right? So no matter what type of motion we have in two dimensions, if we are able to spell out our choice of axis, our choice of origin, our, say, values of the initial and the final coordinates, our values of the components of the initial velocity vector, and the information about the acceleration vector, you can get the complete results. Right? So one can have very interesting problems related to different situations. Let us say talk of a simple interesting problem. Suppose we consider a particle executing a projectile motion, which has been projected from the origin with some velocity u, some angle theta to the origin. Then this is the parabolic path it follows, and this is where it hits the ground. So you can define what you call as the maximum height and the range of the particle. But suppose I say, okay, in this parabolic path, I can take any number of points on the parabola, and use that to construct a number of triangles which have, oh, let's not call it R, call it, say, some C. So I can construct a number of triangles with vertices A1, A2, A3, so on. Right? The sides of these triangles will make some angles, say alpha and beta, with the horizontal line or the x-axis, right? Suppose I calculate the sum of the tangents of the angles made by any one of the triangles with the sides of any one of the triangles with the x-axis. You do the calculation and you can very easily prove that this sum will be always the same no matter which triangle you take. Say here for this triangle it will be some alpha dash and beta dash. For the third triangle it can be alpha double dash and beta double dash. What you will find will be that tangent alpha plus tangent beta is equal to tangent alpha dash plus tangent beta dash is equal to tangent alpha double dash plus tangent beta dash. Now you have to prove that. What is the simple approach that you can follow? Okay, you consider any one triangle. So just to avoid confusion, now let me say about the other angles. You consider any one triangle and let its vertex, top point on the parabola, be at some height h, right? Then h by x will be tangent of alpha. But h and x will also be related to each other through the equation of the projectile, because this point is also a point on the parabolic path of the projectile. So if I say, okay, this point A1 is reached at some time t, then I'll also have the equation x equal to u cos theta t and y equal to, or h equal to u sin theta t minus half gt square. So I'll have a relation between tangent alpha and the trigonometric functions of the angle of projection. Similarly, I can write for tangent beta. Tangent beta is h divided by this distance. The difference between the point where it hits the ground again and x. So this distance will be the range of the projectile minus x, right? So I can write again tangent beta in terms of the value of h, which I have again written in terms of the coordinates u and theta, right? I can eliminate t. So I can write h in terms of that. And I can write this also in terms of this. So range minus x is equal to this. And x I have already written in terms of the coordinates u and theta. Right? So using the formula for the range, using the fact that the x and y coordinates of any point on the projectile are going to be equal to u cos theta t and u sin theta t minus half gt square, using these facts and the simple trigonometry of the situation, if I now work out the values of tangent alpha and tangent beta, I'll find that it is in terms of u and theta only. And they are a characteristic of the projectile that has been thrown up, right? Therefore, irrespective of if this sum comes out in terms of those quantities only, then it will be the same irrespective of which triangle I choose. And I will therefore be able to prove that tangent alpha plus tangent beta is a constant for all this, right? If I am given a similar version of this problem, that I define a triangle which has the vertex as the highest point of the parabola and the other end as the range point where the projectile again hits the ground, then I can again find a relation between the angles theta, alpha and beta. Theta, alpha and beta, right? Because in this case then, the sum of these two distances is equal to the range and this distance is equal to the height. So you can write tangent alpha, tangent beta in terms of these distances and the height and relate this with u and theta. So you will very easily find a relation something like 4 times cotangent of theta is equal to cot alpha plus cot beta. But you can work it out, right? So once you are given this basic information, once you are able to fix the basic coordinates, then you will be able to spell out the details. You notice that if you say again look at the way we defined the velocity vector at any time for the projectile motion and the displacement vector at any time, then you can very easily again work out that at the highest point of its path, the velocity vector becomes horizontal and has a magnitude just equal to the y component. At the end point, the velocity vector becomes exactly the same in magnitude, but has a angle of inclination minus theta to the horizontal. So you just have to use the appropriate conditions. Highest point, the velocity vector is to have a vertical component whose magnitude is zero. Remember, at the highest point of the projectile, the velocity is not zero. It is only the vertical component of the velocity that becomes zero. The horizontal component remains constant. All such results related to maximum height, related to range, they can be very easily worked out once you just write these vector equations, okay? So, remember then, no matter what the nature of the two-dimensional motion, you can very easily work it out. And you can use these ideas for relative velocity also. So, when you are talking of relative velocity, what we are saying is that we are looking at the motion of a particle from two different frames of reference. In two-dimensional motion, we will talk of the frame of reference in the xy plane only. So we are talking of the motion from two different frames of reference. And if we are able to define the coordinates of the particle with respect to these two frames at any given instant of time, then we will be able to define the velocity with respect to the two coordinate systems, right? Velocity will just be the rate of change of displacement with time, right? And in all such situations, ordinarily what we assume is that the origins of the two coordinate systems are coincident at t equal to zero, right? And if the moving coordinate system is supposed to be moving with, let us say, some constant velocity, let us say denoted by v, parallel to the x-axis, the moving system is moving with some constant velocity parallel to the x-axis, then at t equal to 0, the coordinates, because the origins are coincident, the coordinates of any point with reference to the two systems will be one and the same. Because at t equal to 0, the two systems are one and the same, right? The second system has not moved at all. So at t equal to 0, x, y, x prime, y prime, these are the coordinates. Then this x and x prime are equal to each other, y and y prime are equal to each other. At any time t, because this origin would have moved as per our assumption to the right, a distance equal to v times t, the x coordinate as measured from this moving origin will now be smaller than the x coordinate measured from the fixed origin by an amount equal to vt. So we will have x dash equal to x minus vt and y dash equal to y, right? The coordinates in the original frame are x, y. So here this is 0. At the start, the origins are coincident. So all the coordinates initially are 0. The displacement in the first frame will then be xi plus yj. If we are considering the general case of two-dimensional motion, the displacement in the first frame of reference will be just xi minus this. And in the displacement in the second coordinate system will be x dash I plus y dash j, because the starting position is 0 in this coordinate system also. Now this will be written as x minus vt I. Remember, vt is also along the x-axis, so it will be also with the unit vector I. And this will be just y. So the velocity in this frame of reference, ds dash by dt dash, will be dx by dt minus v times I and dy by dt times j. In this frame, It is by dt times I plus dy by dt times t. So v dash vector and v vector, what will they look like? And let us say, just to avoid confusion, put capital V for these. And because small v we are using for the velocity of the second frame with respect to the first. So in the first frame, it will be just dx dt times I plus dy dt by times t. The difference between these two will be what we call as the relative velocity. So you can see that v dash minus v is then simply minus v I. Right? V dash minus v is minus v I. And if you write v minus v dash, it will become plus vi, right? So that means the frame of reference velocity will determine the relative velocity of this, right? So you can use this idea wherever that is needed. For example, if I say now talk of again a problem related to projected motion involving this idea of relative velocity, I can say have a situation where a ball projected with some velocity at some angle theta has a certain range. Now, if this projection is now done not from a stationary frame, but from, let us say, a vehicle moving with a speed v, right? Then how much will be the change in range in comparison to the original range? Suppose I am asked this problem, right? How much is the change in range compared to the original range? So what will this case mean then? The horizontal component of the velocity of this projectile, this will be different from this, right? So here it will be just u cos theta. But here, that this velocity of the vehicle in the x direction will also get added. So you'll have to take that for determining the range. But what you must remember is that if only this change is made, then there is no change in the vertical component of the velocity. It is projected with the same speed and the same angle from the moving vehicle. So there will be no change in the vertical component of velocity. And if there is no change in the vertical component of velocity, the time it will take to reach the highest point and the time at which it will hit back the ground, that is the time of flight, will still be the same in the moving vehicle. Right? So whether you are able to grasp this point or not, I can again frame it in the form of a multiple choice question. I can say, okay, you are having this projectile from the ground. The same projectile with the same speed at the same angle of projection from the moving vehicle, right? The range, time of flight, maximum height in the first case, R H T, second case R dash H dash T dash. So each of the following results are correct. So you can say R equal to R dash equal to R, H dash equal to H, T dash equal to T, or I can say R dash not equal to R, H dash equal to H, T dash equal to T. So that will be my correct choice. Because if I am just moving the vehicle horizontally, that is only the horizontal component that is going to be affected, and that is going to affect the range. The time of flight is determined by the time taken to reach the highest point and double of that, right? And that is determined by the vertical component of velocity. So there is no change in that, right? So even when there is a relative motion, you have to keep the overall situation in mind and see what change has been affected and which coordinate it is going to affect. So once you are clear about that, then you can very easily come to the correct conclusion. So let me say, recapitulate the basic idea once again. For any two-dimensional motion problem, you have to first select a suitable origin and a suitable set of coordinate axes. So for example, if you are given this problem, okay, the projectile is thrown from the top of a tower where it will hit the ground, right? So normally you tend to solve this problem in two steps. How much time the projectile will take to come back to the same level, the level of the tower, and then at that point it has a velocity which is the same as the original velocity, but it's directed vertically downward. So the vertical component of velocity is this, the horizontal component is this. Then we work out how much time with that vertical component it will take to reach the ground, and in that time how much additional horizontal distance it will cover. So we add the range to that additional horizontal distance, and then we say, okay, this is how far it will hit. But if you follow this approach, then it becomes a very straightforward, simple problem. You have the tower,